Hey, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Welcome to Grace. Grace is here to bring God's grace to your life. What a beautiful morning with the sun shining to gather together in God's house. Pray that you know more of God's grace and his love and mercy and forgiveness for you and for me. As we gather to know God's grace, gather today around his word and at his table, we have the season of Lent that is coming quick. So on February 14th is Ash Wednesday. We'll begin gathering on Wednesday evenings for worship at 7 o'clock. That all starts on Ash Wednesday, February 14th. Just make note of that. As we grow together in friendship and faith in God's Word, there's opportunity to be in God's Word. See the grace notes if you're interested in joining a Bible study. There's plenty to go around. And then as we show God's love, we are going to be on those Lenten services on Wednesday. We also gather for a meal, and so our soup suppers. And that's going to start actually the 21st, 1 week after Ash Wednesday. We'll start with the suppers. Be thinking about how you can serve each other in bringing some soup or salad or dessert for that. And we just want to highlight that time together. It's a wonderful time. So, but we need food to eat. If we're going to gather to eat, we need something to eat. So think about being a part of that in our life together. And then, of course, what a great gift the ministry of our preschool is to our community, to share Jesus and to grow these kids in knowledge. And so our registration is open. Get the word out. Please keep the preschool and your prayers. It's a wonderful, wonderful thing. So, good. All right. Oh, Bob, come on up, Bob. Our fearless leader.
I promised at our excellent party celebrating 30 years of ministry for Pastor, I said that I had a special gift for Renee. So, Renee, here is your Eric Majeski bobblehead.
Hey, wait, is it skinny?
Hey, it's pretty skinny. Hey,
it's got a little belly on there, probably accurate. Oh, that is too much.
Yes, it is. If it's a little belly, it's probably not accurate.
Oh, Lord. Yeah. Okay. That's weird seeing yourself in a bobblehead. Yeah, see, now, yeah, for sure. All right, so all the change we need, and here's the transformational reality that God brings to us in Jesus as he encounters people along the way in life, and the change is this. The change will happen from the inside out. From the inside out. And what does that all mean? We'll unpack that as we take a focus of our hearts on Mark chapter 1, verses 29 to 39. And this is, if you want to grab a Bible now, this is going to be one of those messages where I'm going to kind of walk you through the verses. And so it's helpful sometimes to have it in front of you. So if you want to dig around, or if you just want to sit back and listen, that's fine too. But just so you know, that you might find it helpful to have a Bible in front of you to follow along. So, good. All right, we're thankful to be gathered for worship on this glorious day. Let's stand as God calls our hearts together.
And we begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Please pray with me. Gracious Father, in a sin-filled and broken world, you sent your Son to bring about change in us, in order to reconcile us to you, something that we could not do on our own. Open our hearts and minds to be attentive to the guidance of your Holy Spirit. Fill us with the good news so that we can fulfill the command that you have given your people to go out and preach and to teach the saving gospel of Jesus Christ, bringing the good news to the ends of the earth, so that all may hear it and believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Savior of all. Amen.
Amen.
So remain standing for our opening song.
Oh,
confession. Our Lord, our help is in the name of the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand?
But with you there is forgiveness. Therefore you are feared.
Together as God's people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking His grace for the sake of Christ, and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner.
Almighty God, have mercy upon us.
Forgive our sins and lead us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Almighty God, in His mercy, has given His Son to die for you and for His sake. He forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, I declare with great joy your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let's remain standing for our song of praise.
Message. Okay, I want you to think that you're at a table ready to eat. Got it? All right. What do you want to be served? What do you want to be served? Brussels sprouts?
Yeah.
Yo. What would you like to be served? What's your favorite thing to eat?
Oh boy.
Fish. Okay, I like it. Fish. I was not expecting fish. But that's awesome. Avery, what do you like to be served? You like fish too. Wow. Like with a, you know, like a tartar sauce or something? Hazel, you can't say fish. There's got to be something else. You like salad. Okay. That's it. You guys are healthy. Oh, I love it. So, but it's sometimes hard to think of things we do every day. Every day you sit at a table and you're served something to eat, right? It's just an ordinary thing. It can be you're sitting at the lunch table and you get your lunch. It could be when you're at home and you're having dinner and you're served lunch. Well, we have from the Bible one of those really kind of, it's simple as that. Jesus enters into a home and he gets served dinner. But what is amazing is the one who served Jesus first, Jesus served her. She was sick, and Jesus served her by healing her. He cared for her. And then she turns around and serves the people at the home. And so there's this beautiful kind of remembering that Jesus serves us. He loves you, he cares about you, he gives you all the things we need in life, even the food on our tables. And then we turn around because we've been loved and served by Jesus. We're able then to serve each other, to care about each other, to love each other. Okay? And you can invite me over anytime. I like fish. I like fish. Yeah. And salad. Sounds good to me. All right, you guys can go back to your seats. Thanks for coming up. We're going to turn our hearts and our minds to God's word. And Jack Clock is our reader. I caught him on the way in. He was, you know, running a little late. I said, Jack, you're going to read today. He said, oh, are there any hard words? Grasshopper looks like it's about the hardest one. So, all right.
We'll see how this goes. Our Old Testament reading comes to us today from Isaiah 40, verses 21 to 31. Do you not know? Have you not heard? Has it not been told to you from the beginning? Have you not understood since the earth was founded? He sits enthroned above the circle of the earth, and its people are like grasshoppers. He stretches out the heavens like a canopy and spreads them out like a tent to live in. He brings princes to naught and reduces the rulers of this world to nothing. No sooner are they planted, no sooner are they sown, no sooner do they take root in the ground than he blows on them and they wither, and a whirlwind sweeps them away like chaff. To whom will you compare me, or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes to look to the heavens. Who created all these? He who brings out the starry host one by one and calls forth each of them by name. Because of his great power and mighty strength, not one of them is missing. Why do you complain, Jacob? Why do you say, Israel? My way is hidden from the Lord. My cause is disregarded by my God. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel today comes from Mark chapter 1, verses 29 through 39. As soon as they left the synagogue, they went with James and John to the home of Simon and Andrew. Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they immediately told Jesus about her. So he went to her, and he took her hand and helped her up. The fever left her, and she began to wait on them. That evening after sunset, the people brought to Jesus all the sick and demon-possessed. The whole town gathered at the door, and Jesus healed many who had various diseases. He also drove out many demons, but would not let the demons speak because they knew who he was. Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. Simon and his companions went to look for him, and when they found him, they exclaimed, "Everyone is looking for you." Jesus replied, "Let us go somewhere else, to the nearby villages, so I can preach there also. This is why I have come." So he traveled throughout Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and driving out demons. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ. Thanks, Jack and Lucy, chiming in. That's nice. Had to hear Dad's voice. I thought that was so cute. You can stay standing or be seated. It's up to you. No, go ahead. Sit down. All the change we need, and it felt like for me, for this message, I needed a change. I had thought through, kind of, you know, mapped out kind of where we were going to go, thinking about the transformational realities of Jesus in our life, right? And so I thought, I'm going to take a solitary kind of subject and preach on prayer, you know, this moment where Jesus is praying. I thought, we'll just kind of do a sermon on prayer. Well, all that changed. And so this is not just a sermon about prayer. It's a sermon about the way God works transformation in our lives and the change that he brings about. It is from the inside out. And so we're going to be inside a home. We're going to be inside the heart of Jesus. We're going to get inside the mind of the disciples. And then we'll be out. We'll be out on a porch. We'll be out in a desert place. We'll be out to the ends of the earth. From the inside out. So let's start on the inside of a home. This is verses 29 to 31. Right? Where Jesus is invited into the home of Simon and Andrew. And Simon Peter's mother-in-law is under the weather. She's sick. She's got a fever. And there's this beautiful moment that Jesus enters into that very ordinary kind of happening, right? All of us can relate. We've all had sickness in our home, some kind of feeling that we've been under the weather, a little cough or maybe, 100.3 fever, maybe even a little more, but just, not really life-threatening, but sick. That's what Jesus walks into. And there's an instructive kind of thing, I think, for us about the change that God works in our hearts from the inside out. Because here we see Jesus attentive and active, even in this very ordinary, small kind of issue in the life of someone who's just a bit under the weather. Because I think sometimes in our own hearts, I don't know about you, maybe you have had this sentiment or this feeling. There's some big issues out there. There's some big problems. God doesn't need to bother with the small, ordinary kind of stuff for me. Why should I bring my kind of little things to God, who's got much bigger problems than just me? And yet that's not how Jesus works. He says there is no small and insignificant. He is tuned in to every detail. Your life, no matter how small and insignificant you feel, Jesus is attentive and active to our need. And so there Jesus is in that very ordinary home and a very ordinary situation. And there's this moment where he just reaches out and lifts her up. And then we see the transformation. This one whom Jesus served, whose life Jesus touched with his healing, now just serves. And it's not like, listen, it's not like this mother-in-law of Simon Peter was healed from this disease, this fever, and then she goes out and she discovers penicillin and, brings healing to all the people. No. She's served by the Master, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords in this house. She's lifted up. And what does she do? She serves by just giving a meal. And there's something really transformational in our own life about that. That when Jesus has served us, he has served up for you and for me a love and a forgiveness and a touch that says, you're mine. As we saw in Isaiah, he lifts us up. And he just says, and to us, now that we've been served, right? Let's serve others. And it could be as simple as the people in your house nearest to you. And simple things, like even providing a meal. Think about having been served by Jesus. Now we're called to serve others. What does that look like for you? What change can be brought about by even simple kind of ways in which we can serve each other? So from the inside of the home, now we go to outside on the porch. And people are bringing all kinds of suffering and heartache and this desperate reality of all the brokenness to this porch. The sun has gone down, and there now the Sabbath is over, so everybody around is bringing all of that desperate need to the porch because that's where Jesus is. So just on Friday, there's something new on my porch. It's a Ring doorbell. You know what that thing is? So it's this thing, it has a camera, and it detects, you can ring it like a regular doorbell, it'll do that, but it's got this camera, and it detects anything that moves on your porch. And so I installed it and so I have my phone with me, and so I installed the Ring doorbell, and it doesn't matter. Anytime anybody comes near it, or even if you go out to take out the recyclables or anything, my phone is buzzing in my back pocket. I'm getting nervous. I'm like, what's going on? And it's just, I can't imagine what it would have been like. It's just for me, like, oh, someone's going outside. I'm not used to it. Could you imagine if Simon Peter on his home would have had a Ring doorbell on his porch? I mean, if you have your nose in the Bible, you can see the desperate need, wave upon wave, about being brought to Jesus. His phone would have been ringing off the hook with all that need. And yet Jesus I'm closed for business. Can't handle it. I'm tired. It's been a long day already. He doesn't close the door. He steps out. He steps out into all of that desperate need with a heart of compassion and a healing touch. And so it is in our life that Jesus doesn't look at the desperate need and say in your life or my life or the people around us and say, nope, can't do it. He steps into all of it. And what changes here for us is to see how Jesus encounters the need. We see people bringing others to Jesus. And that is what we can be about as Christians. We know the desperate need that is in our own hearts and maybe in the lives of others, and we can bring them to the places where they can receive what God has to give in His word of love and forgiveness and life. We can do that. But in verses the earlier, we saw actually Jesus being brought to others. And they brought Jesus into the home. And so that can be what churns in our lives too, in the face of all the desperate need to bring Jesus into it, in our own lives, in our own witness to the people. Right? And now we move in verse 35 out to a desert place, and here we get inside the heart of Jesus. And we go from this pressure of what that this day brought to prayer. Because sometime Jesus, it says very early in the morning, it's still dark, he goes out to pray. And we see the heart, this close personal relationship that Jesus has with the Father. Because what do you do with all of that pressure that life can bring and all of the need that was placed at the doorstep? We see what's being done. Jesus brings it to his Heavenly Father. So what do you do with the pressure that life can bring? What's happening in your heart in the midst of all of it? And the changes to just not let that pressure build up till we explode, but we have a place to kind of release all of that. Jesus invites us to bring all of that burden and pressure and all of it to the Lord in prayer, to take it to the Lord in prayer. And it can be as simple to share with our God what's inside our hearts and to get it out in prayer. It can be in the ordinary grind of your day, whatever is building up and you're thinking through all the anxious thoughts and all the things, you can turn all of those thoughts just into prayer. Well, whatever you're feeling, just pray it. Or the prayer can be just as simple as, Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Prayer doesn't have to be this complicated kind of thing. We see this transformational kind of heart of Jesus that just sees it as this very kind of personal way to share what's in here and get it out to the God, his Father, who he knows hears him. Right? I thought it was interesting. Did you see in the news that Elmo made the news this week? Did you hear about this? So you know Elmo, the Sesame Seed character, right? The little red puppet that's so goofy and has this kind of fun little laugh. You know, Elmo. I can't do it. I can't do the voice. But and so Elmo, right? The Sesame and Elmo. It turns out this Sesame Seed character has a presence on social media. Did you know that? And so here's what Elmo does. He puts out on the internet. Just asks a simple question on social media. Friends check in with friends. How's everybody's day going? And the internet blows up. I mean, people just start unloading these burdens that they've been carrying. I mean, it's not just little kids kind of learning their alphabet. It's real kind of adult heartache and stuff that people are just unloading on who? Elmo! And I'm thinking, here we are. As people who have weight and burdens and we don't need a red puppet. We have a God who invites us to say, unload. I'm checking in. Share your heart with me. Even if it's not so good. From the inside of our hearts out to our Heavenly Father who cares for you deeply. And then finally, right, we have this change that happens from very near to far. From those who are near to those who are far. Notice the progression in these 10 verses, right? We go from the synagogue into the home, from the home to the community, from the community to out to the ends of the earth, out into all of Galilee, and eventually, really, around the world. That's how it happens. And this is for our own lives as Christians. We come gathered here in this place for prayer, to receive God's word, to be filled with his love and forgiveness, to taste and see that he's good at his table. And we take what we receive here in church into our homes. And that's where we live out all that we've received in love and forgiveness and grace and mercy. And then from our homes into our community, to those you're working with, to those you're in school with, to those that you're on the sidelines watching kids with, to those that you're in sport, whatever, right? All those neighbors. And then out to the world. And I don't want you to think that you got to be some kind of, you know, missionary that's going across the world. Because we as Christians can become so very insular. When I say out, sometimes the distance of where God's grace and mercy and gospel needs to go isn't a kind of physical distance, like in miles. Sometimes the distance is between just those that are distant because they're distant in age. There's a generational gap. It doesn't matter the generation. We all need the gospel of God's grace and mercy. And you can speak into someone who's older than you, and if you're older, you can speak in the lives of those who are younger. And everything in between. Sometimes the distance is culturally. They're just from a different culture. They're right here next to you. But they eat different foods. They dress different. And it's just the different. And so that's the far. That the heart of God is for all people, even those that are different that way. Sometimes the difference is even in what the way that they think about life, or you name it. Sometimes there's the distance. And the transformation that happens in our hearts is to know that even for those far from us in the way that we think, Jesus' love and grace and mercy is for them too. And so something happens in our hearts that expands it from the inside out to those that are out there, to know that God's love is extended there too. So, here we are inside. You'll be inside your homes. But may what the transformation, the change that happens in here would be extended to those out there. May it be so for God's glory. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to stand and confess our faith. Oh, no, we're going to sing. That's what we're going to do. We're going to sing our song of response. There is one gospel. Let's stand and sing together.
Of this old story that rescued me. Praise to my my Savior, the King of life. I stand in the gospel of Jesus Christ. And in glory still I will sing a blessed old story that rescued me. Praise to my Savior, the King of life. I stand in the gospel of Jesus Christ. Praise to my Savior, the King of life. I stand in the gospel of Jesus Christ. I stand in the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Let's confess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated as we bring our blessings now before our God in the time of offering. Thanks, Kevin. Let's pray. Lord, we bring to you just a portion of that which you've blessed us with as we give to you now our offerings. Would you use what is brought in the here inside to proclaim and to share and to serve those outside? We pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Now we turn our hearts and minds to prayer. We have some prayers that people have asked us to speak out loud and to ask for an extra measure of God's blessing. We're praying for little one-year-old Roland Winchester. Roland is having some stomach issues and is undergoing some testing, so we pray that it would be not traumatic for little Roland and that they would find that there's nothing wrong. We ask that God would certainly be with him and with the family as he goes through these tests. We're also praying for Marge Bernard. Marge is in the hospital. Saw her the other day. She has a kidney infection. She should be coming home today, but keep her in your prayer. And Jack, this is especially hard on him, traveling back and forth to the hospital. So keep them both in your prayer for safe travels, for peace of mind, for comfort, and for healing. I saw Lynette Hay on Friday. Lynette is coming along great. She's still healing, and we pray that God would continue to heal her. She hasn't lost her sense of humor. That is still there. When I said I was coming, she asked me if I would bring a makeup kit and scissors. To which I said no. But anyway, keep her in your prayers. And Barry as well, as he cares for her. We're also praying for Carol Rapinian. Carol is the sister of our Susan Euchre. Carol is in the hospital with multiple issues, and now on top of that, she has COVID. So we pray for healing for Carol and peace of mind for Susan as she sits by her sister. We're also praying for Joanne, the niece of Lorraine and Bob Barrow. She's a missionary in Germany, and she has contracted bacterial meningitis. So please keep her in your prayer, that God would stretch out his healing hand upon her and give her strength to continue in his work. Let's rise and go to the Lord in prayer. We give thanks to you, dear Father, for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh to preach the gospel and to bring about a change in a broken and sin-filled world. Cast out the works of Satan and the corruption of sin, which we cannot overcome. By your word, rescue us from every evil of body and soul. And Lord of the church, you give to your servants who preach the gospel that hearing may many would be saved in every nation, sharing the blessings of Christ. Heavenly Father, give to all Christian homes the endurance that comes through your Holy Spirit, that husbands and wives, parents and children may be disciplined and self-controlled in their duties. Let them run their course in this life and continue to the end of the holy Christian faith, and at the end of life to hear these words, "Welcome home, well done, good and faithful servant." Almighty God, creator of the world and its foundations, you hold sway over the powers of nature and the rulers of the earth. Graciously preserve our land, its produce, our industry, and our leaders. Do not disregard us for our sins, but renew us, that our lives may be peaceful and our country governed according to your good and gracious will. O Lord, your Son is the great physician of body and soul, by whose hand demon, disease, and every ill must turn away. We bring before you now those that we named and those that we now name in our hearts. Heal them in your time, Father, and in accordance with your good and gracious will. Holy Father, where there is forgiveness of sins, there is also life and salvation. Bring us in faith your holy sacrament that the blood of Christ, which atoned for our sins, may make us whole. Strengthen us against every spiritual attack of the devil. Turn us in love toward our neighbor and preserve us in body and soul to life everlasting. Into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now let's join together in the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let's remain standing for our closing song. anyone would like intercessory prayer, our deacon, Robin Spaulding, and his wife, Cheryl, will be up front. Please come forward, and they will pray for you or with you. With that said, let's now go with our God's blessing and benediction. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Amen.
Amen. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Have a great week, everybody.